Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Pleasant Street. My name is Steve. Matt is on vacation this week, so I'd like to welcome Bill Vist to preach this morning for us. I'd like to invite Kate Martinkin to come up, and she has some announcements to make. Somewhere.
Yes, I hope you saw the pictures that were streaming through there. We had lots of kids in this building, lots of volunteers in this building, and it was really wonderful. We had 45 volunteers from 8 different churches. We had about 65 kids from 15 different churches and some unchurched. We collected food for the NAC food pantry, and we collected money for a dorm fire in Uganda. It was an awesome week, and we're already planning for next year, so let me know if you want to join us next year. We also have something else coming up on Wednesday, July 26th at 7 p.m. We have a youth worship night, so we're inviting all high school and middle school students, and invite your friends to come and worship. We're also looking for if any of you high school and middle school students would like to be on the worship team that night, then I'm pretty sure Allie and Kaden are heading that up. So let Steve know that you want to be a part of that and we can add you in. We'd love to have more. Oh, last minute. It didn't look like we had anybody here that needed the nursery. But if you do need the nursery, then we can open it. We're just not streaming, so we won't be able to see the service on the TV down there. So I was letting the volunteers know maybe you can stay upstairs. But I'll be right over here on the side. If you do need nursery, then please let me know, and we will make sure somebody is down there. Thank you.
Friends, if you would just rise in body or spirit, it is called worship, Psalm 25. Come lift up your hearts to the Lord. In you we trust. Do not let us be put to shame. Our God is full of compassion and love.
He brings sinners back to his way and teaches the humble the way they should go.
Show us the right path, O Lord. Point out the way for us to follow.
Lead us by your truth and teach us, for you are the God who saves.
Thank you.
ways he has blessed us, giving us one blessing after another. God gave the law to Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. Now let's sing, Your Grace Is Enough. Church. We have not done your will and have rebelled against your love.
Our hope is in you all day long.
Let's take a moment to God, this time of confession. Hear this good news, friends. The Lord is faithful in all his words and gracious in all his deeds. The Lord upholds all who are fallen and raises up those who are bowed down. Through Jesus, your sins are forgiven. So our morning offerings this morning are for our ministries here at Pleasant Street. I'd like to invite the deacons to come up. We'll be passing the baskets around. Let's pray. Generous God, we've known your unfailing love, faithfulness, your care and provision. Lord, you give us everything that we need. You provide us with nothing that we don't. We pray this morning, Lord, that this offering will help build your kingdom and spread the glory of your name. In your name we pray.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, now it's not.
starting our service, we'd like to thank God, and we'd like to enjoy spreading the peace. So Jesus came to earth, and he spread the peace among his people. So friends, turn to your left and right. These are your brothers and sisters in Christ. Let's spread the peace. The peace of Christ is with you.
Your kingdom come. Father, we long for the restoration of your world, the new heaven and the new earth. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. There is so much happening in our world that is contrary to your will and law. We pray for persecuted Christians around the world and ask you to provide and protect them. We pray for peace in Ukraine and Sudan and many other areas of the world where there is war and conflict. Father, we pray for those who mourn, thinking especially the family of Melissa Harrigan today. Surround them with your comfort and peace. We pray for all who mourn the passing of a loved one, both recent and far past. Thank you for the hope we have in you. We pray for those who are struggling with health, for Jack and Rick and Hank and others. You are the great physician. Lay your healing hands on them. Bless Deb B as she has surgery this week, and we pray for a quick recovery. We pray for those who are lonely or isolated by age or infirmity. Help us to be the hands and feet of Jesus to bring comfort, cheer, and companionship. Give us today our daily bread. Thank you for providing for us. You give us every good gift. We pray for those looking for work, provide opportunities for employment. Thank you for providing a wonderful BBS week. May the gospel seeds planted in the hearts of the children grow to maturity. And forgive us our debts, as we have forgiven our debtors. We turn to you again and again for your forgiveness. Work in our hearts so that we might live to walk and talk as Jesus did. Help us also to be forgiving to others. Help us not to hold grudges, but to have fellowship with each other with love. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. We covet your protection from temptation as it is all around us. Help us to walk in your ways, even when it means going against the cultural flow. Help us to resist evil and embrace good. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from Deuteronomy 34, verses 1 through 12. Then Moses climbed Mount Nebo from the plains of Moab to the top of Pisgah, across from Jericho. There the Lord showed him the whole land, from Gilead to Dan, all of Naphtali, the territory of Ephraim and Manasseh, all the land of Judah as far as the Mediterranean Sea, the Negev, and the whole region from the valley of Jericho, the city of palms, as far as Zoar. Then the Lord said to him, "This is the land I promised on oath to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, when I said, I will give it to your descendants. I have let you see it with your eyes, but you will not cross over into it." And Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in Moab, as the Lord had said. He buried him in Moab, in the valley opposite Beth Peor, but to this day, no one knows where his grave is. Moses was 120 years old when he died, yet his eyes were not weak, nor his strength gone. The Israelites grieved for Moses in the plains of Moab 30 days, until the time of weeping and mourning was over. Now Joshua, son of Nun, was filled with the spirit of wisdom, because Moses had laid his hands on him. So the Israelites listened to him and did what the Lord had commanded Moses. Since then, no prophet has risen in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face, who did all those signs and wonders the Lord sent him to do in Egypt, to Pharaoh, and to all his officials, and to his whole land. For no one has ever shown the mighty power or performed the awesome deeds that Moses did in the sight of all Israel. This is the word of the Lord.
It's good to be back.
Oh. He came in with a bang. It's good to be back here again. I'm looking at this space and I'm thinking a couple of good things. It is cool and it's definitely less humid, but also we're closer together. I've preached a few times in there and you guys, some of you love the back. And I can't quite see my eyes are getting open. Anyway, it's good to be back. Just a real quick personal update for me and Sandy. The last time we were at Pleasant Street was over 5 months ago. And people may be thinking, well, Bill and Sandy have given up on the faith. Well, no, we haven't. We left here back in mid-February. We spent 4 months in Harrisia, North Carolina, a little bit, a little town. It's a cross corner in the middle of the country with a church on one corner, a Christian school on the other, and fields all around, and we had a great time there doing interim work. Been back 3 Sundays. This is the 3rd Sunday, but we didn't come here. I've been preaching elsewhere the last 2 Sundays, so this is my first chance back, and it's good to be back. I have friends here. We love all you people, so good to be back. But you're not going to see a bunch of us because in 3.5 weeks we're heading west, and a church in Edgerton, Minnesota, a little town in southwest Minnesota, has asked us to come out, and so we will be spending 3 months doing interim work there. And kind of interesting, you have Edgerton Bethel on the street, directly across the street, you have First Christian Reformed Church. It would be like if St. Patrick's was a Christian Reformed Church, and they were there and we are here. That's how close they are. And those churches together, those two churches, have a membership that is greater than the population of the entire town. I mean, country churches are different. It's kind of neat. So we're looking forward to that. So you won't see a lot of us, but it is good to be back. When I preach funerals, and when I think about my own funeral, I ask the question, what mark has this life made? What difference has it made to the world that this person lived? What difference will it make when I pass that I live? How will I be remembered? Will it be positively? Will it be negatively? How long will I be remembered? And my own desire for myself, and I think for a lot of us, is that
in some way, our lives will make a mark in this world so that when our time comes, we leave the world a little bit better in some way than we came into it, that we were a part of improving something. And the question is, can we really improve this world? And I suggest to you that we can. To make a... Is there a place I could stand that wouldn't get that feedback? I mean, I can preach through it over it. I'm just, if it bothers me, I suspect it's bothering some of you. That's better. Thank you. Probably if I speak up, my voice is big enough, you wouldn't even need, no, we won't go ahead and be recorded. But it's been said about Christians by some that we are so heavenly minded that we are no earthly good. Many of you have heard an expression, probably that exact expression. All we think about is getting to heaven, and we all get to heaven, what a glory that will be. And because of that, we don't really make a difference, but I think it's just the opposite. I love what C.S. Lewis said. He said, if you read history, you will find that the Christians who did the most for the present world were precisely those who thought the most about the next. It is since Christians have largely ceased to think of the other world that we have become so ineffective in this. I'm going to explore the possibility with you this morning for just a few moments that our lives can really make a difference for the good. And the issue is, if we don't try to improve the situation, we don't try to build something better for our family, for our community, for our church, we end up with all kinds of problems. And all we're doing is living for ourselves so that we can get rich and we can have power and we can enjoy life. What ends up happening is we end up terribly lonely. John Mellencamp, many years ago, sang a song that said, just sad and disgusted is what you've grown to be. That you have no idea that this is what your dream would turn out to be. When you live for yourself, it's hard on everybody. Get that? When you live for yourself, it's hard on everybody. But if you did it your way, man, you did it all. How did it feel to be the big daddy of them all? And when we live for ourselves and we ignore the, I'm being distracted. My phone is buzzing in my pocket. I just said to Sandy, I always remember to silence my phone because it would be so embarrassing to be up front and have it ring. Well, it's just ringing. And can I turn the vibe? Someone tell me after we're talking, turn the vibrator off. So living for ourselves leads to isolation. It also leads to missed opportunities. I have taught classes and I have actually preached on basic biblical principles of time management. And one of the things I have highlighted is that if you blow time, if you waste time, you will miss out on all kinds of opportunities. Opportunities to improve yourself, opportunities to interact with friends and family. You will miss out on opportunities because you're just blowing time on stuff that doesn't matter. And if, in fact, you do pay attention to trying to improve our situation, what ends up is that we improve our lives, we improve our relationships, and we do make this world a better place. If there's anyone whose life made a difference in this world, it's the man we just read about. Moses. I mean, look at the difference he made. He led the people of Israel out of Egypt. He took them to the edge of the promised land. He's a central figure in three different world religions. The three world religions, I believe, if you put them all together, comprise the majority of observant people in the world. Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. Millions, billions of adherents. Deuteronomy 34 tells us about his death and what comes next. And I want three things to come out of this chapter to help us learn how you can make, I can make a difference. We can improve this world. And the first thing is kind of a somber note, but it's worth noting at the beginning. When you die, you will be mourned. I hope. Unless you're really, really a stinker. When you die, you will be mourned, but no matter how good your life is here, how much difference you've made, it won't be forever. Listen to this, verse 7. Moses was 120 years old when he died, and his eyes were not weak, nor his strength gone. The Israelites grieved for Moses in the plains of Moab 30 days until the time of weeping and mourning was over. They mourned and they wept for 30 days, and then life went on. Friends, that's the way it should be. That's the way it has to be. Now, I like to think sometimes, because I'm not that proud. When I die, this world is going to spin out of control, and it's going to become an awful pit of destruction and death, because this is no longer here, but I know that's not true. It's not true for me, it's not true for you, it's not true for any of us. Life goes on. Want a sobering fact? When you die, and there's a service perhaps, and then you have a procession to the cemetery, you have that gravesite in the middle. Do you know what the greatest number one fact that's going to determine how many people are at your gravesite is? It's not how much you're loved. It's not how big your family is. It's not how much impact you've had in this world. The number one biggest factor that's going to determine whether we have a lot of people or a few people there is it's raining. Fact. I'm not trying to depress you. I'm just trying to impress on you that you will be mourned, you will be remembered, and I do believe that how long and how fondly will depend in some extent to how you live your life. But the reality is that none of us will be mourned forever, because life goes on. And so if we're going to make a difference that actually changes the world longer term, the first thing we have to do is devote ourselves to a vision greater than our own lives, something that will outlive us. Verse 1 again. Moses climbed Mount Ebal from the plain of Moab to the top of Pisgah and across from Jericho. And he showed him the whole land and it named a whole bunch of regions. And then the Lord said to him, this is the land I promised on oath to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob when I said, I will give it to your descendants. I have let you see it with your eyes, but you will not cross over into it. Why wasn't Moses allowed into the promised land? Why couldn't Moses go into Israel? And some of you, many of you are going to know the story, but it comes down to a failure of leadership, really a failure of obedience. In Numbers 20, Moses is again, as he did so often, dealing with the complaints of the people. I will tell you, Pastor Pat, I love this passage because we all know about dealing again with the complaints of the people. This is okay, that's why we're here. I'm not complaining about it, it's reality. And the people are saying, you brought us here to die. We're dying of thirst. There is no water. And Moses prays to God, and God comes to him, and he says, talk to the rock. Talk to the rock and tell the water to come out of it, and it will. And so Moses went up to the rock, and he took his staff, and he hit the rock, and water came out, which isn't what God told him to do. And then he stood up in front of the people and said, look what we have brought you. Well, now why did he do that? Because once before, the people complained, saying, you brought us out of Egypt, and we're dying of thirst, and there is no water. And that time, God said, well, go to that rock, a different rock, in a different place, and hit it with your staff, and the water will come up. And so in Numbers 20, God says, because you did not trust me enough to honor me as holy in the sight of the Israelites, you will not bring this community in the land I give you. Now, seems like a harsh judgment for one little mistake, if you will. He just did what he had done before, but it's God's right to make the judgment, and he had disobeyed God. And the key point is here that our failures and our mistakes will limit our effectiveness. They will make a difference in how much we can accomplish in this life. And there's not one of us can't look back on life. And for those of us who are of a certain age and accumulated a certain number of birthdays, it seems like those moments that we regret seem to continue to accumulate. And yet, in spite of the fact that we look back and say, if only I had had greater faith, I could have done so much more. Or if only, you know the old saying, no one ever on their deathbed said, I wish I had spent more time in the office. And yet how many of us who are of a certain age don't look back and think, when I was young, why did I spend so much time in the office instead of playing ball with my kids? You know, it's a balance issue, but we make mistakes. David wasn't allowed to go into the temple or to build the temple because he was a man of war. Moses couldn't go into Israel because he failed in obeying God. If it happens to men like that, it can happen to any of us. It's interesting, over the last probably 10 to 15 years, we're really beginning to see it. Do you remember back in the 80s when the megachurch movement really got going? I can remember. One of our missions sent me to Crystal Cathedral to learn how to build a big church, and then they sent me to Willow Creek and Bill Hybels to learn how to build a big church, and then they sent me to Saddleback and Rick Warren to learn how to build a big church. What's interesting is that those ministries are discovering that instead of being built around a vision greater than the leader, they were built around the leader. Instead of being built around accomplishing something greater than they themselves could, it was built around them. And so what they're finding is that while that pastor is there, and I will tell you, these are great communicators. Robert Shuler, man, can that man preach? Bill Hybels, I am in awe. Rick Warren, I wanted to just take his sermons whole and preach them because he does a lot better than I can. But what happened when Bob Shuler moved out of leadership? That Crystal Cathedral is now a Catholic cathedral because the ministry got there. What happened at Willow Creek when Bill Hybels fell into error? It's still there, but it's a shadow of what it once was. I have to wonder what's going to happen to Saddleback when Rick Warren moves on. I don't know. I pray that Rick has had the wisdom to build a community and a team of leadership that is not dependent on him, but so often, while the pastor is there, the church sizzles, and when he passes, the church sizzles. Moses' leadership ultimately wasn't based on himself. It was based on the vision that God himself had placed before the people, saying, you will go into this land, and you will conquer this land, and you will take this land, and you will be my people. It wasn't the case that if Moses can't enter the promised land, then none of us can enter the promised land. It wasn't the case that Bill Hybels has failed, and so this church is going to fail. It was just more than 30 days. And then they moved to the Jordan, and they continued the mission that Moses had set before them. And then they got their God. I will tell you that through my career, and I served six different churches, including this one, which was 10 of the best years of our lives, my greatest fear as I served has always been that when I left, some of what we had been able to accomplish would just disappear. Sometimes it has, sometimes it hasn't. But the goal should always be, whether it's in our families, you know, moms, dads, grandparents, friends, someday we're not going to be here. We want our kids to be able to stand firmly in the presence and service of our God, even when we are no longer here to lead them. If you are in business, if you own a business, or if you lead a business, your goal should always be that when you retire or there's a tragedy and you die, that business will continue to grow and become greater than it was. If you're building a team that can do that, which leads us to the third point. The way we do that is to build a vision that will outlive us, to have a mission that is greater than what we ourselves can accomplish, is to invest time and effort in building those who will come after us. Verse 9. Now Joshua, son of Nun, was filled with the spirit of wisdom because Moses had laid on his hands on him. So the Israelites listened to Joshua and did what the Lord had commanded Moses. I think this may be the most important work that Moses accomplished his entire life. He spent years, he spent decades raising up a successor, training Joshua. He laid his hands on him. The Spirit of God is involved in this. But don't lose sight of the fact that it was Moses who lived his life in such a way that Joshua was prepared to step into that key leadership role when he was no longer here. Paul said to Timothy, the things that you have heard me say in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to reliable people who will also be qualified to teach others. Well, this was God's plan. Paul said, Timothy, young pastor Timothy, I'm not going to be here much longer. Timothy, I taught you. You heard the word of God from me. You have been prepared. Now your job is to find others to train up in this same word so that when you are no longer here, they can take it beyond where you are. And think about how God's plan worked. You start with a little group of disciples huddled in a room in Jerusalem. And then on Pentecost, God poured out his spirit. And that handful of disciples, led by Peter at that point, stood and proclaimed, you are the ones who killed the Savior that God sent. But you can be forgiven. You can be received. Jesus Christ is the way of life. And 3,000 believed. And we read in Acts 4 that more were added daily. And then you get this Paul, this persecutor, this Saul at the time, who was an enemy, but God's Spirit and voice of Christ, he heard it. And he was changed, and he taught Timothy. And out of a small handful in an upper room, today we have a community of faith numbering in the hundreds of millions. Really, I should have looked up. That's how many Christians are estimated to be in the world. I'm not sure. I think it's like 1 to 2 billion, somewhere in there. And that's a big change, and it was all because generation by generation by generation, people who had heard the truth of God passed it on to others and said, now we pass, you lead. One more sobering truth, and we'll be about done. I hope that you accomplished some things in your life that you have accomplished if you're my age. If you are the age of some of the other people here, then you will accomplish your children. You know, life is what it is. We move through the stages. I hope that you accomplish some things that you look back and say, that's good. I made a difference for my children. I made a difference for my grandchildren. I made a difference for the children I taught in school. I made a difference in the community in which I held an office as a mayor or a selectman or something like that. Sorry, select person. I hope there's something in your life, things that in your life, you go back and say, well, that was good. But I want you to understand that the best things that can be accomplished are not through you, but through the people that you have prepared to take your place. Do greater things than you yourself could. We can accomplish more through the people who come after us than we'll ever accomplish on our own in this life if we dedicate ourselves to building them up. So you want to make this world a better place? Make your life's work to help people. Ease their suffering. Connect them with opportunity. Help them increase in knowledge. Know their potential. That's what we do with our children, our grandchildren. We want to see them grow. We do that with our co-workers. We do that with our employees. And when the time comes when we leave this world behind, life will go on. And we'll do more. know, we will be forgotten. But we need to ask ourselves these three questions. Am I living for something bigger than myself? Am I inspiring others to move on to greater visions of what God can accomplish? And am I investing my time in loving my children, building my children, loving my grandchildren, building my grandchildren, and teaching the children in Kid Street and in Echo in just a few minutes, and helping adults learn what it is to be a deacon and an elder and to do it well, and investing time in mentoring people so that they will be the best that they can be, so that through them, God can do great things. This world can be a better place. We should be part of it. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for the opportunities that you give us to be a part of other people's lives, to love other people, to encourage other people, to comfort other people. Build your society, to make a difference on all the things that confront us as struggles with race relations and financial inequity and all of the issues that we spend so much time on. We have a place in addressing those things. Help us to be the people who, because we are heavenly minded, are doing a lot of earthly good. Your purposes for your church, your purposes for your world are good. Lord, make us a peace. I pray that about in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, I want to invite the Echo children, and Brooke is going to introduce them to come to the front.
Students in grade 3 through 5 are invited to come up to be dismissed. People of God, what is our prayer?
Yeah.
Give you his peace.